Hi everyone, thank you all for coming and thanks to Nottingham Contemporary for hosting us. So my name's Nathan, I'm part of the team at the Film London Artists Moving Image Network, or FLAMIN for short. So we support artist filmmakers in various ways. We do development programs for early career artists, production grants, and of course the Film London Jarman Award, which is why you're all here today. So the Jarman Award has been running for 15 years, and it celebrates innovation and experimentation in artist moving image in the UK. So each year, a group of nominators, curators, film programmers, artists, nominate one artist each, and then from those nominations, a jury selects six artists in the shortlist. And then they'll be meeting again this week to choose the winner, who will be announced on the 22nd of November at the Barbican Centre. So the award's named after the iconic filmmaker, activist, gardener, Derek Jarman. Yeah, it just aims to continue his legacy of exciting and kind of path-breaking, radical filmmaking. And anyway, I will finish and hand over to Channon, who will introduce this evening's screenings.
Thank you so much, Nathan, for that introduction. It's my pleasure to welcome you to this year's Jarman Award touring program with Rosa-Johan Uddoh. My name is Jan Ambutur, and I'm the curator of live programs here at Nottingham Contemporary. As Nathan briefly explained, we're in great company with Jarman Awards selection this year. I mean, some of you might have remembered Grace Ndiritu's Black Beauty, who that was screen here for our within our exhibition, Our Silver City last year. Onyeka Igwe's So-Called Archive, Alberta Whittle's Lagare, and of course, Rosa-Johan Uddoh's Black Parole, and Morgan Quaintance's Surviving You Always, and Jamie Crewe's False Wife. Today we welcome Rosa-Johan Uddoh for the screening of her works, Brown Paper Envelope Test, Black Parole, and Culture Field, which will be a 10-minute extract only, so you won't get the full film, unfortunately, but hopefully you will have the chance to experience the full-length film soon. Once the screening is over, Rosa and I will have a quick conversation just to open up some of the themes that her work encompasses and touches on, and then we will open the floor to you, so you will have the chance to pose your questions. Before introducing Rosa, I would like to share some brief housekeeping notes. Our live programs open up different interventions and propositions within our curatorial research across the organization. Although we will keep an informal atmosphere throughout the evening, our talks, performances, and screenings seek to create challenging environments where open-mindedness and respect for each other's approaches and perspectives can foster growth. So please be mindful and respectful of each other's opinions and views. I would like to take this opportunity to show gratitude to the University of Nottingham, Nottingham Trent University, and Film London Jarman. Of course, I mean, I won't be giving the whole length of the of the name, but for generously and graciously supporting today's event, as well as acknowledging my colleagues, Philippa Douglas, Jim Brower, Tom Chamberlain, Catherine Masters, and Lachlan Hui for making this event possible today. So without further delay, I'm delighted to introduce Rosa-Johan Uddoh. Rosa-Johan Uddoh is an interdisciplinary artist inspired by Black feminist practice and writing. Solo exhibitions include Stuart Hall Library in London, Blue Coat Gallery in Liverpool, Focal Point Gallery in Southend-on-Sea, and Destiny's Atelier in Oslo. Group shows include Workplace Gallery in London, Pioneer Works in New York, 68th Institute in Copenhagen, and Exile in Vienna. Her work is in collections including the Arts Council Collection. She won the ArtQuest Peer Forum Award at Camden Arts Centre, received the Sarah Band Lee Alexander McQueen Foundation Scholarship, and selected by which was selected by Nick Knight, and is a New Contemporaries artist. So many thanks for joining in today's event. Thank you, Sam. How are you, first of all?
Good.
Great. I mean, thank you so much for these generous and compelling films. I mean, what I find very fascinating is the humor that you employ that makes the work so memorable and receives this emotional immediacy. And I very much appreciate how accessible it becomes. And I mean, we will talk a bit about it like later on, but I guess like I'm aware that how accessibility is so important for your work. So I guess I just want to kind of like start from the beginning, at least for me, because of course as a kind of, you know, moderator, I can only just talk about my experiences and try to find a way to make them more accessible for our wider audiences. So my journey with your work started at in 2018 through New Contemporaries. And I remember witnessing your work and looking at the kind of looking into, you know, how you describe who you are and so on. I remember what I found so fascinating is the way you define your work as a way to kind of achieve maximum self-love. And I guess I'm quite interested in the way you describe how using performance could be a medium to kind of come closer to, or how using performance can be confirmative to establishing one's identity. So I was just wondering, I mean, in terms of how with these three films, with Black Perio, with Brown Paper Envelope Test, apologies, as I said, I'm slightly ill, so my mind is slightly hazy, and somehow, I don't know why, names are the ones that I'm having
That's
the most difficult
one.
Exactly. Brown Paper Envelope Test, and also Culture Field. I mean, we can see that how these work, I mean, kind of, you know, how performance kind of take shape and how you perform and how you empower that performance to take place through the work as well. So I was just wondering this intersection that you create, I mean, with, you know, this kind of achieving radical self-love and also this conscientious attempts to shift the narratives through performance. So could you talk a bit about that? Because I know it's very present in your wider work as well.
Yeah, sure. Can you hear me okay? Is the microphone? Yeah. All right. Yeah, thanks for that question. And it's really nice to see the works on the big screen. So in terms of, yeah, maximum self-esteem and making performance in order to reach maximum self-esteem, one of the reasons I became interested in performance in the first place was because I was really interested in performances that already existed in popular culture. So how they, like what we watch on TV, you'll see there's a lot of TV references in my work, for example, or what celebrities do, or what politicians do, or what, you know, people who are very visible do, and the way that they move, how that provides like a template or a guide for you to follow, and how the way that I behave have been shaped by the people that I'd seen on TV growing up. So I started to really think about that at the moment when I like just, you know, decided to begin my artistic career, which was relatively late. Then I thought about making performance myself for the first time as a way that I could both speak to this idea and think through and act out how these performances had affected who I had become at that point. This is when I'm about 21, 22, but also then to slightly adjust that and provide potentially alternative models and ways of being for myself and other people like me. That's one reason why I kind of set out. It was very much, it was quite a selfish impulse to think about how I could learn more about myself and about the performances that I do and the performances that I repeat, and think about how to become more authentically myself through performance and through practice, as opposed to through writing or through something else that was disconnected. So really to kind of tackle it at the heart of things.
Mm.
Yeah.
Maybe it's helpful for us to kind of open up some of those influences that you were talking about. I mean, I know your work, I mean, as a generation who was born, you know, like in the 90s, as me, as I, and I know I mean, maybe this question is slightly for me as well, because I wasn't born and raised in England. So for me, these kind of understanding of these references of pop culture might not be exactly as accessible. So I know, for example, with Brown Paper Envelope Test, I'll get there. And it's not like it's the first time I watched this film. So, you kind of, you know, with the with the first film, with the second film, so Black Perio, you give references to Edouard Glissant, Sadia Hartman, Franz Fanon, and so many others. Of course, Agatha Christie is the main one. And then with Brown Paper Envelope Test, the reference is slightly more embodied and kind of hidden and lived. So each reference somewhat opens up a certain kind of history of British Black history. So you imagine, by imaginative and creative interviewing, so you somehow open up a different potentiality, almost as a kind of homage in the methodology. It's almost homage to Sadia Hartman. You kind of, you know, create this wavered and experimental kind of narrative where it feels. You shift directions, you rewrite the canons and so on. So how does these influences kind of play part in plotting, you know, the work and sketching up the work? I guess to be more specific, what certain moments in history that you find the influence from, or what states, you know, dynamic in your mind that is affecting the kind of work you create right now? Just to kind of give a background history. I know in one of your interviews you did mention Serena Williams in Wimbledon. So I guess that's one of the moments that I'm aware that has influenced you dearly. So maybe it's beneficial to talk, I guess, more what these influences are, and then how you kind of, you know, bring them into the work.
Yeah, sure. So I guess I should say about performance, I think that there's one way of thinking about it, which is what I kind of just described before, which is about how what I personally am watching and engaging with in the media is affecting who I become and my own self-formation. But there is a wider social element to it, one where it's about how, so you can take it to like a kind of more collective level, for example. Something that I think about in all my work and basically all of my pieces touch on is about what does it mean to be Black, and how does this idea of Blackness, how has it been created carefully and deliberately over hundreds and hundreds of years in this country? So there was a time when the term Black didn't exist, and that was before the transatlantic slave trade, and it was at that point of encounter when slave ships came to Africa that they started to divide things into Black and white. Before then, we didn't think of race in that same way. So and this is something that has continued. So then they were kind of then they defined race through conversations and through laws, for example, and through paintings and the media of the time. And this continues to this day. I recently revisited watching Luther. Which is really interesting because, obviously like that made Idris Elba kind of really big in the UK. He previously did have a strong career in the US, but he is British and kind of had to go there in order to make that. But it's interesting even to look at how in our very recent history, between where we are now in terms of thinking about race and how we would depict a Black man now and how we depicted a Black man just maybe like 10 years ago, how an idea of race and what is acceptable and what performances we show has really shifted. I guess that's what I'm looking at in all of my work. And I think that's in terms of when I look at something like Luther, or I look at something like something that I talk about a lot in my, one of the first pieces, that performance pieces I made was about Serena and Venus Williams and watching them play tennis on TV and growing up watching these Black women in the very white elite space moving their bodies in really extreme and fantastic ways, was that I was not only aware about how this shaped me and my understanding of Blackness and my understanding of who I was, but how it was shaping other people who were Black, but also other people who were white, other people who were Asian, other people of all different races and all different backgrounds, how it shaped their ideas of what it meant to be Black, meant to be Black, because this is something that is formed like on a very social level. When it comes to your question, which was There was a reason that I started saying this.
Maybe I was talking about like certain performances that informed you and inspired you and that you carried with yourself and became this kind of, you know, depositories of, you know, knowledges almost, and then how they affected your work and how much.
It was the basic. So when it came to understanding performance myself, it's a very my practice is a very personal study. I went through all of the different kind of influences and programs, and you kind of and different things that I remember from my childhood. Like a lot of my process is really about thinking back into my childhood and unpacking it and thinking, what did I see in my formative years when I was 13 years old? How did that shape my ambitions? Okay, I didn't become a tennis star. I tried, but I didn't. But, you know, I definitely watching Venus, especially Venus, because for me, I was the older sister, and this and when I grew up, Venus Williams was really the star. And now, again, recently you see a shift. Obviously, Serena Williams is a huge celebrity in many ways. But I learned from Venus Williams that it was a good thing to be the only black woman in the white space, that was something that was not in terms of, not politically, but you know, she was given a lot of credit for that, and it was fantastic. It was amazing. Everyone admired her. Everyone thought it was amazing what she was doing in terms of breaking boundaries and stuff. And, you know, growing up, I grew up in Croydon. It was very racially diverse. And, you know, I was surrounded by lots of black people. But then, you know, I went on to go into, as I pursued a career in academia, I went on to go into places that were predominantly white, predominantly very elitist, very British places, in a way like Wimbledon, like tennis. It's a very white, very white space, which has a very idea of a particular kind of girly femininity with, like, the white skirts and the white dresses. And all of the etiquette that comes with that. And I didn't see so much of a problem with that, actually, at first, because that was respectable, right? That was the path to excellence as a black woman that I had seen on the TV screen. So that's, like, one example. I guess in the works that I've shown today, though, just to talk, like, really practically speaking as an artist, Black Poirot... it's probably the work that you can see this most clearly in about how I use references. My first step when I wanted to make this, and the reason that I chose Black Poirot was because Poirot is something that I used to watch all the time with my grandpa in Wales when we go there, like half-time school holidays. We would just watch it, just smash it out every day. And so I was like, wow, this isn't really like something that would be necessarily considered black. In fact, it would be considered a very like white reference or like the epitome of British establishment. But I was like, let's tackle this. Let's see what I got from it. Because after all, I was a black child. And there was something that was hypnotic about it to me. So I engaged with it. And what I did was I like very basically from my memory and extensive knowledge of Agatha Christie's Hercule Poirot, I broke down the structure of every episode. So there's like a basic formula. So that's what you see kind of in these kind of swirly blaxploitation graphics that kind of title cards that come up kind of at intervals during the film. And from working out that formal structure, which exists in the books and exists in the films and the TV series, I then kind of inserted into that my own experience. And I think, yeah, I guess for me, that is my experience of making art, is about thinking about how being a black woman in the diaspora, as I am, for me, that experience is very much one of being a detective. Is one of being trying to find out, like, a detective of one's own life, but also a detective of black history and other ways of being and other ways of performing.
Wow, okay. I mean, I have many questions, but I guess one will be to just, since we're now talking about Black Poirot, is your collaboration with Collective Text, because I know Black Poirot was a work that you initially created in 2018, and then you went back to it, and then you continued developing the work and made it more accessible over the years. So can you talk about that process and how that happened, and yeah, I mean, where the kind of intention came from and so on?
So, this is another great thing that I learned during this period of work. Because when I first started to make this, and I think this was actually the first film that I ever made, I'd previously just been doing live performance. Mm-hmm. And it was really great for me to realise and to allow myself to come back to this film again and again and like keep shifting it and keep tweaking it. And there are multiple reasons that I did that, but basically in 2020, so after I made the first version, I made the first version of the film, which was great because then I got like loads of great feedback, and then I decided I've got some more to do here. And in 2020, I think, yeah, in the pandemic, I had the opportunity to show it in New York, and as a result of that, there was a lot more money that came with it. And I decided that I wanted to represent the same film, but I really wanted to work hard on making it accessible, because accessible to the deaf and hard of hearing. Because at that point, it was just the sound and the visuals. And it's very visually sparse. As you see, it's like mainly a black screen for a lot of the work, or it was. Now there's a lot of captions. So I was recommended this Glasgow-based collective called Collective Text, who do what is called creative captioning. So it's kind of a they take an artistic approach to the work of captioning, and the process was very, very intensive. I had no idea at the start. I was just like, oh yeah, subtitles, easily. They can just, you know, write them, you know, and it'll be fine. And that was like quite ignorant, and it actually took months and several meetings. And as you might see in the credits, you know, one of the great parts of the process. So first we do this transcript, which is simply writing down exactly what's said. Then you have the audio descriptions, which is thinking about how to describe sound in ways that are visual or include other aspects of the senses. Because of course some people, well, there's a really big spectrum of people who are deaf and hard of hearing, and some people can't hear anything, some people can hear some things, some people hear in different ways. So it was really about thinking what is it about the sound that I'm trying to get across, and thinking about how to write that down in words. So that was something really big that I learned from that. And then also, yeah, the animation, which really comes into its own by Daniel Hughes. And that was again about like getting across something of the tone and the playfulness of the vocal, as well as literally what it's actually saying. And working with David Ellington as the consultant, who he is a deaf artist himself and an excellent filmmaker. And we also had a BSL interpreter, so we would have Zoom meetings where David was talking in BSL and then we had a BSL interpreter who would translate. And he watched several drafts of the captions and would give critique on that, about how accessible that was for him. So it was a really integrated process, but I think it really made me aware of actually how much film often excludes. The deaf and hard of hearing, and how even the basic captions that we sometimes get are often really still relegating the experience of deaf and hard of hearing people to a much lesser level. And I think for me, as someone whose primary focus for a long time has been thinking about blackness and how black people are treated in spaces, I think it's really important to think about how people who have other positionalities that place them that society places as a disadvantage, because I think it's really telling how some lack of access is considered acceptable and some is considered not. Like, it is considered still quite acceptable amongst hearing populations to not have captions on films. Most events don't have that, and that's kind of seen as okay. Like, oh, we didn't have the budget or whatever. Like, it's kind of seemed like, well, you know, it's okay if that doesn't happen. Whereas, you know, to think of an event where you don't allow black people to come in, that is now considered as unacceptable. But, you know, if you have an event where you actually invite black people, welcome black people, make it, you know, there is still a long way to go. But these are all levels of different levels of accessibility. So, I mean, it's really interesting to think about the wider community of people who are left out of gallery spaces. And this is something I learned loads about through revisiting this one particular film and working with Collective Text.
Thank you. I'm just conscious of time. We only have 18 minutes left, so maybe it's a good moment.
Okay, really long.
No, that's perfect. Thank you so much. It's been indeed helpful. So maybe it's time to open up the floor and then just welcome your questions.
Thank you. Interesting work. Yeah, I like it. There seems to be an explosion of this black culture pushing it against, almost like pushing this ideology against white people's faces. Have you noticed any resistance towards the work involving the blackness, this almost resurrection of black identity?
Not to my face. have I noticed any resistance? I think that there's a big community, as you say, there's a big community of artists making work like this at the moment, dealing with these themes, and I think that's really great. And I guess, you know, much like you were kind of touching on the beginning about like humour, like I like to use a lot of humour in my work. I like to surround, because I like to have fun while making my work. I want to feel good, even though I'm like dealing with like difficult topics. I also surround myself with people who are interested in similar themes and who are, because I want to move past that point of no, racism doesn't exist, or no, like this history isn't real or whatever. Like I want to actually go deeper and beyond that. So I think that lately I haven't experienced that, but I don't think that's because it's not there. I think it's just because of how my practice is, and a lot of my practice, like you see even with the football film cultural field at the end, like it's all like all of the players there, they're women, they're non-binary people, they're trans people, there's a lot of black people involved in the production and mainly behind the camera in that one. So you know, my work in itself is really gathering kind of a community of practice. And yeah, like Josephine Melville, who played my mum in Brown Paper Envelope Test, she was a fantastic black comedian and set up like the first black female comedy troupe called the BB Crew in the 90s, which actually used to include Janet Kay, who sung us out in Black Poirot. But like, you know, a black female comedy troupe. That's something I didn't have any idea about before I met Josephine Melville. And then I was like, wow, this has been going on for a long time. And so that's very much the space that I'm making my work in. But yeah, resistance, I'm trying to think. I think there's always resistance, but it's just, I just find it quite boring. And I think that, you know, I feel like I have space to move forward in myself.
There's so many really amazing quotes in Black Poirot, but where Glisson's talking about opacity and certain things about identity can't be known, it really strikes me in relation to Brown Paper Envelope Test and some of the ideas about things, you know, pinning things down with the DNA test, or the idea of passing as something as kind of misread, you know, you think you know who or what someone is, but then they're not. I wonder maybe if you could speak about, I don't know, about that, about knowledge and things in those two works.
Yeah, thanks. So I guess Brown Paper Envelope Test deals with this idea of passing, which is an idea that people would perceive you as a certain race that you're not, or also it could be a gender that you're not. So this term in particular comes from, or is popularized by, a book that Nella Larsen wrote in 1929, a black woman who lived in Harlem, and the book is called Passing. And it's actually recently been made into a Netflix show as well, but the book is fantastic. In Brown Paper Envelope Test, I'm playing with an idea of racial passing, which is like about, I guess, skin color, also about passing, how you might pass academically. So I guess the idea of like your A-level results, like coming in the post and thinking about how that might be a way of gaining access into a community that perhaps people didn't think that you belonged to. And then also, a biological idea of race, which is I guess, again, being popularized through this idea of taking DNA tests to find your racial identity as if race is determined on biology, which is not. As I said before, it's very much a social construct. Thinking about Black Poro, so that, I guess that's what I'm trying to critique there, is that idea that you could ever really know. There is no objective truth, right, to anything, but specifically to the idea of race. And so similarly, I think Edouard Gasson is talking about a way which allows us to live with that. Do we have to constantly define ourselves, and what could be another way of being? And that's how I understand his idea of being opacity, of being opaque, of not being completely known. But I think, I think it just comes in a lot with this idea of having to let things go and having not to know comes in a lot in terms of Black experience. I can do loads and loads of research into Black history, but there'll be stuff that was never documented. There'll be stuff that was actively destroyed. There'll be propaganda that is made to tell alternative stories, as we're finding now with the story of Una Marson, for example. You can look that up, but I won't go into it. But thinking about how perhaps crimes of the past are now being retold in different ways in order to make different people look good and look better than things actually were at the time. If you think about, the criminal justice system, which I think is a real underlying theme in Black Poro, thinking about Black people in relationship to police, although it's not an overt theme, often you deal with, many Black people have to deal with inquests and deal with situations where they don't know the what, why, who done it. You don't get that kind of same tying up of a crime or understanding of a cause of death as you would in an ideal Agatha Christie murder mystery, or perhaps you would in another experience of life. So I think that not knowing is something that you have to come to terms with in many ways, I think, as a Black person. And I think Edouard Gasson, it's not something I'm an expert on, but I think it was interesting for me to come across that someone had started to theorize and write this out.
If there are no questions, I have a question, actually. So you just touched upon this, how you use humor and playfulness as a method to talk about complexities of our realities. And I did mention this to you before, and your practice and your general approach reminds me so much of this quote by Maya Angelou, people never remember what you said or what you did, but they remember the feeling you leave behind. And I feel like your work just gives such emotional immediacy that you directly, it becomes so memorable. So I guess in terms of using humor within your work, I know that you have touched upon it, but I guess, with your performative work and your background, I guess how much kind of consideration it is when you're actually working on a project or a film or a new work.
Yeah, thanks. I think I'm naturally just quite a funny person. So mm-hmm. It started to happen quite accidentally. But then I have obviously thought about it a lot more and how to translate it. And I think a film that is a really big reference for me is Shrek. The movie, because I love the way that works in terms of how you've got multiple.
This is what I meant. Sorry about that.
You've got multiple layers, right? Are you okay?
I'll be hopefully.
You got multiple layers of meaning. There's something for the kids to watch and laugh at. There's something for adults to watch and laugh at. There's and there's jokes that will go over the children's heads, and it can be enjoyable like that on multiple levels. And I think the way that it does that is humor. That is through humor. That is how humor works. It can. It's very complex. One sentence, like a pun, can have loads of different meanings, right? And for me, that was something that was interesting in thinking about how to tell quite complicated, complex, quite dense stories. So you see in like a really good example is the football one where, you know, there's football players called like colonialist and landlord. They're all played by women, trans people, and non-binary people. It's all in the shape of kind of match of the day film. There's this like commentary over top. There's like so many layers to it. And there's, you know, Alexandra Burt's Bad Boys playing the background. I hope that on some level it hits people, and I hope that also, I think the thing that working with multiple layers as humour allows can do is also, I think it like triggers people's existing experiences. And I think a big thing about humour is like the reason, one of the reasons you might laugh at something is in recognition. So I think for me in my work, I really want people to identify with what they're seeing. I want people to recognise. I want people to think, oh yeah, I remember. That reminds me of something that I've seen on TV when I was like 7 years old. And I think that means that you have a little bit more of a buy-in from people. Mm. That means that it's more accessible to people. They'll feel more welcome to enjoy, but also to critique the work and to, you know, have like their own opinions about what's been said. And that's really important to me. Like that's, I don't want to show work and like everyone be like silent and reverent towards the artist or the work or the space that we're in. I think laughter is a really great way to like break down barriers for, which sounds quite corny, but I think it can do really great political things. And yeah, to bring it back to accessibility, it means that even if perhaps you don't understand or you don't have the same understanding of my work as perhaps I do when I was making it, you have some kind of like embodied understanding. Mm. if you laugh at something and
somehow it stays dynamic in your mind and just leaves something behind. It just, you know, the residue is always there. And I guess that's why it's so powerful watching, you know, Black Power, for example, or also Brown Paper Envelope Test. I didn't. I mean, we have time for one more question.
I'm just wondering what sort of movie you're going to make next.
What film am I going to make next? Ooh, yeah. That's a really good
question. Is it an addition or something new?
Well, Cultural Fields, which you saw at the end, is actually 50 minutes long. So that was just a short extract you saw. And that's my latest film, which you can see is going to be shown at next at Workplace Gallery in London from the 24th of November to, I think, the 14th of January. So if you have time, please come. And yeah, in terms of next, I don't know. Like, I would quite like to... I would really like to like kind of move into a more mainstream space with my film work. Maybe like TV and thinking about how to like make a kind of TV series. So I have a couple of ideas for that. And perhaps something about the life of Una Marson, who was like the first Black producer to work for the BBC. Or yeah, I have quite a few ideas, but I think in terms of format, I think it would be interesting to, I guess move out of the gallery space, because I find just like the more feedback I get, the more interesting it is for me to make the work. So I think that, you know, like I make work, you know, predominantly with a Black audience in mind, and I think that unfortunately galleries are still quite inaccessible places for Black people. So I think, yeah, I would like to move towards other audiences. Yeah.
Do you like Maya Angelou's work?
Do I like Maya Angelou's work? Yeah, I do. I don't know much of her work, to be honest, but I have read some. Yeah, and I like it. Oh, that's a beautiful poem.
Maybe one more question.
It's kind of related to the not one question, but are there any other popular culture references that you're kind of dying to get in? I guess they're the thing that I was just like, yeah, I'm really excited by what might come next.
Yeah, I'm actually working on a pantomime at the moment. that's a live show for the Brighton CCA Theatre. So that would be in 2024. So I'm interested in a pantomime. Well, pantomime is something that I went to like every Christmas, still do. But like thinking about that as something, again, just like a Poirot episode, something that is very like entrenched in British culture, but also has like, you know, Jamaican pantomime is a huge thing as well. And obviously as a former British colony, they've taken that, but then made it their own. And so there's a lot of research for me to do there. But it's something that can be like kind of broken down quite easily into its tropes. Like, what is the black feminist pantomime horse? I don't know yet, but but I want to kind of find out. Yeah.
Saying that.
Thanks.
I guess that's it. Thank you so much, Rosa. This has been so pleasurable. And then for those of you who want to refer back to this conversation, the recording will be made available in the next few weeks. I mean, a round of applause for Rosa, and hopefully, fingers crossed, for November 22nd.